Hi, this is Jeffrey Reddick, creator of Final Destination.
Greetings, Slashaholics. This is David Bergantino, author of the Freddy Krueger's Tales of Terror books, the Bard's Blood Horror Shakespeare books.
Hey guys, this is Jason Brooks, Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th Vengeance.
Hey, this is Slasher Pepper.
Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, part 6.
This is William Pattison, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morris.
Hi, this is Deborah Voorhees from Friday the 13th, part 5.
Hey folks, this is Adam Marcus, director of Jason Goes to Hell and Secret Santa.
Hello kiddies, this is John Kassir, the voice of the Crypt Keeper.
Hi, this is Kane Hodder, better known as Jason from Friday the 13th, Victor Crowley from Hatchet.
And you're listening.
You're listening.
And you're listening.
And you're listening.
I just want to make sure you guys know you're listening.
You are listening.
And you are listening.
And you are lucky enough to be listening.
Okay, boils and ghouls, you are listening.
You are listening
to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
The 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.
Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons from the Patreon page. That's Cecilia Spears, Hawaii, Carl Leakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Iron Alexa, Allison Seib, Ryan Woodward, TikTok 12, Bree, Bonanza Jellybean, and Kai Antez. Thank you guys so much for supporting the channel through Patreon. And if anybody listening right now enjoys the content of the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel, and would like to help keep it going and growing for a long time to come, then click the link in the description below and sign up on Patreon for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some great rewards depending on the tier you select, such as the $2 tier gets you the early access content, the $5 tier gets you the early access plus a free ebook emailed to you every 3 months, and every 12 months you get a free gift from the merch store. There's also a $15 tier that gets you a free gift from the merch store every 6 months, a free ebook every 3 months, and you can appear on the podcast and voice a character in an audiobook narration once per month. So there's many choices to choose from. Just click the Patreon link in the description below and check it out. Child's Play 2, The Novelization, Chapter 13. Kyle played with the dirt, making small holes in the garden. Then she stuck in one of the bulbs that Joyce had given her.
Grow!
She ordered it, grinning.
I can't believe this. Me? Gardening?
She had as much interest in gardening as reading the books assigned in English class, which is to say, none. But Joanne and Phil were big on gardening.
Yeah, they probably think it's therapeutic. Bending down, crouching near the dirt, real therapeutic,
Kyle thought. The only fun part, as far as she could see, was cutting the worms in half and watching the two halves wriggle away in opposite directions. That part was pretty neat. She had always hated worms ever since the cat food incident. She didn't know how old she had been when it happened. Probably around 3, she guessed. It was just before her mother had left. Old Mom had had a habit of disappearing for a long time, leaving Kyle all alone in their dark apartment. She dug the spade into the dirt, carving out another irregular hole. Mom left, and after Kyle stopped crying after she knew that her mother wasn't coming back, she started exploring the apartment. During the day, the cartoons were all gone, and she had to find something else for fun. She turned the taps on in the bathroom sink. She remembered the sound of the water, and she played with her toys in there, a legless Barbie, a pudgy doll with a scuffed face. Her mother was always gone for a long time. The kitchen was always good, even if there wasn't much food in the refrigerator. Certainly nothing like cookies or ice cream. Just some milk, some cans, nothing that was fun to eat. One day, she saw the cat food. The cat didn't stay around the apartment much. It went in and out with Kyle's mom. Kyle looked at the plate of cat food. She remembered leaning down and getting close to it because it looked weird. It was all dried brown and rusty. It had come out of the can all wet and gloppy, and now it was almost solid. Kyle stuck a tulip bulb in a hole. She heard the side door open. Probably Joanne, she thought, or maybe Big Phil checking up on her. She remembered touching the dried cat food that day long ago. I guess it's what kids do, she had thought, touch things, even taste them. Not that she tasted the cat food. She just stuck her finger against the crust, just a bit. I wanted to know what it felt like, she remembered. The crust broke. She remembered giggling, and then her fingers plunged into the dish, past the crusty covering, to a warm, wet mess below. She had been laughing, but she pulled her finger out and saw things moving in the hole. She looked at her finger, and these white things were on her finger, wriggling and moving around. She screamed, though there was no one to hear her. She screamed as loud as she could. She ran to the bathroom and turned on the tap, washing these things off her finger. They're gonna get me, she thought. They're gonna crawl right under my fingernail. They'll get me and turn me into cat food. She grinned. At least that's how she remembered it. Kyle took a breath. Yeah, gardening's real therapeutic. She made a new hole and saw a baby worm try to wriggle away. She brought the small spade down and cut the tiny fucker in two. Then she felt something watching her. She turned around to find Andy sitting on the swing, his feet dangling, not quite touching the ground. She also saw the doll that had freaked him out so much. It was sitting on a bit of wood that Phil kept saying he was going to cut up. Andy was watching her, and she wondered.
Hey, what am I? This morning's entertainment?
She turned back to the small garden.
Kyle,
Andy said. She looked back.
Kyle, do you ever miss your mom and dad?
She thought.
Now there's a dumb question. Maybe the absolute dumbest. I mean, really.
Do you?
He repeated. She took a breath and then stood up. She had big muddy stains at her knees. She looked up at the clear blue sky. After such a nasty night, it certainly looked nice out. She decided that there was no way she'd let herself be grounded tonight. She knew there were ways around that little problem.
Phil and Joanne aren't the most aware couple that have ever had my fate in their hands,
she thought.
You can't miss someone you never knew, Andy,
she said. Andy kicked at the air with his feet. Kyle saw the worn dirt below him, looking sort of broken up.
Where are they?
He asked.
How come you never knew them?
She took some steps away from the garden.
I have no idea where they are now, and frankly, I couldn't care less. My old man left me before I was born, and my mother, she put me up for adoption when I was 3. She was having some troubles.
Kyle tossed the spade back into the garden. Andy nodded.
Do you remember her?
I make a point of trying to forget.
She walked up to the swing and grabbed hold of the ropes.
It's easier that way. Trust me. You'll be better off forgetting, too.
Andy shook his head.
My mom's gonna come and get me. Just as soon.
She looked at his face. He believed that, she guessed, and for all she knew, it might be true. Anyway, she thought.
It's not my job to trash his fantasy. Break time!
She announced.
Move your butt over.
She tried to squeeze on the seat next to him, but instead, Andy popped off, jumped down onto the dirt. And again, Kyle noticed how chewed up it was, as if the rain had ripped it up, or maybe an animal had.
I'll push you.
Andy squealed, running around to the back of the swing, laughing.
No thanks.
Kyle said, but she felt Andy grab the back of the seat and begin to shove it, just a bit forward, then back, and then a bit more. She dragged her feet against the ground, slowing him. Come on, he said. It's fun. Kyle let her foot dangle as he pushed her harder and harder. She heard him suck at the air, grunting, getting her moving. The tips of her sneakers scratched against the bare dirt below the swing, back and forth. And as Kyle swung, she thought of her date that night. She noticed nothing else. Scrape, scrape, scrape. He heard the girl's foot, the toe gliding back and forth over the dirt, back and forth, moving some of the dirt away, some of the freshly dug dirt. Slowly, Chucky turned his head, just a bit, just enough to see her sitting on the swing. Another push from Andy, the little brat, and her toe gouged out a big chunk of dirt. It went flying into the air. Looks like the brat is trying to dig it up, Chucky thought, as if she knows the doll is there. The doll with the smashed head, Tommy. The doll that would make everyone wonder, if this is Tommy, who's this other doll?
Andy, stop!
The girl squealed, laughing. She's enjoying her ride, Chucky thought. Isn't that nice? The boy pushed her harder, sending her higher and higher. Scrape, scrape, scrape. Oh, that damn brat, Chucky thought. I'll take care of you, too. Don't you worry about it. On the off chance that they had noticed the change in his appearance, Chucky moved his head back, looking straight ahead again. A big smile on his wide-eyed face, listening to the sound of the swing, and Kyle's shoe chewing at Tommy's grave. Chapter 14. Joanne leaned closer to Andy so he could see the picture in the book. It felt wonderful to be reading a bedtime story. Humpty Dumpty was on the ground surrounded by a bunch of confused onlookers who clearly didn't know what to do with the broken egg.
And all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty Dumpty back together again.
She watched Andy study the picture. He put a hand on a corner of the book and tilted it down to see better. Sitting close to him in his bed, Joanne could smell his clean hair from his long bath. It had been a good day. He had played outside, and she had heard him laughing with Kyle. At dinner, everyone seemed happy, almost like a real family, she thought. Even Kyle was so sweet and polite. Andy flopped back on his pillow, right beside Tommy. He and the doll seemed inseparable now, and that, she thought, was good. It would make Phil so much better. There's nothing wrong with this boy that a little love won't fix. She looked at her watch and then shut the book.
And they all lived happily ever after, she said.
And Andy held the bedclothes tight against his chin.
No, they don't.
he said. Joanne smiled at him.
What do you mean, Andy? Of course they do.
Did you see Humpty?
He grinned.
I don't think he'll be living happily ever after.
She smiled. Well, they do for now. We'll read some more tomorrow night, okay?
She ran a hand across his fine hair. He nodded and smiled, squeezing his eyes shut.
She reached over and turned out the bedside lamp, and in the sudden darkness, for a moment, all she could see was the doll's glistening marble eyes. A pale blue glow from the nightlight was blocked by the bed.
Remember, she said, Kyle is in the next room, and we're just down the hall. If you need us for anything, just holler, okay?
Andy opened his eyes and nodded.
We'll be here in 3 seconds flat.
She leaned close, hesitated a moment, but then kissed Andy on the forehead.
Good night, Ma.
He hesitated and then said,
Good night, Joanne.
Good night, Andy.
I wish he had said it, she thought. I wish he had said that word, Mom. She smiled at him. Before she got up, she straightened the bedclothes around Andy, and then around the doll. She rubbed the doll's head, feeling the stiff, synthetic hair.
I'm glad to see you've made a friend here.
She saw a bit of a smile on Andy's face. Then she stood up and left the room. He counted, waiting for Joanne to walk down the hall and then down the stairs. He listened for her voice talking to Phil.
She's nice, he thought. I'm lucky. Kyle says that there are a lot of mean, really mean foster parents, but Joanne is nice, and Phil, well, he's okay.
He waited until he was sure Joanne was all the way downstairs. Then he slid out of the warm bed, dragging Tommy behind him, pulling the doll by its hair.
Guess I got a new friend, Joanne had said. She has that wrong, he thought.
He hurried to the chest of drawers and opened the bottom drawer, empty except for a few pairs of socks. He pushed Tommy into the drawer and then slammed it shut. It didn't shut all the way. Something, a hand, maybe a foot, caught. But Andy hurried back to the safety of his bed. He pulled his covers tight and shut his eyes. Now I can sleep, he thought. He lay there trying not to think bad things, things that would keep him up. But he heard a sound, a thumping sound, from over there, from over by the dresser. His eyes opened.
No.
He whispered, prayed.
Please, no. I'm just imagining this. That's all.
He leaned up, looking into the darkness. The blue nightlight lit only a tiny spot on the wall by the foot of the bed. He couldn't even see the bureau.
I've got to look, he told himself. I've got to. Because if I don't, maybe the doll will come to life and get out of there in the middle of the night. I have to make sure.
He would have liked to reach out and turn on the light, but Joanne and Phil might see that. Besides, with the nightlight, he could see pretty well, he told himself. And he saw the drawer close tight.
I thought it got stuck earlier, he thought. It didn't close all the way, did it?
He slid out of bed. The wood floor was cold on his feet. He started for the bureau. But then he stopped and grabbed a magnifying glass on the end table. He had played with it that afternoon, looking at all sorts of things. The grain on the wood, the forest inside the carpet downstairs, the jungle and the grass. He moved closer to the bureau, and when he got there, he reached down for the handle on the bottom drawer. He took a breath.
Please be there,
he said.
Please be there.
He pulled it open as fast as he could, and the doll was lying there, face up, with that same stupid expression on its face. Andy started breathing again. He leaned forward, the magnifying glass held out in front of him. He moved closer until he was right over the doll's face. He suspended the magnifying glass right over one of the doll's eyes, and then the other. They seemed to catch the blue light, and they sparkled with a deep blue glow like the sky at night filled with stars.
It's just a doll, Andy told himself for the 100th time. And then he blinked,
and then the head turned to him. He tried not to yell, to squeal.
Wanna play?
It said. Andy dug around to the back of the doll. He felt the battery compartment, and he fiddled with the latch.
The small door popped open, and he felt the two big batteries.
No.
Andy whispered to it. He shut the battery compartment, and again slammed the chest drawer closed. He ran back to the bed, back to the cold sheets, thinking, now I'll be able to sleep. Joanne stopped the sewing machine. She thought she heard something, but then the wind blew against the window. A tiny breeze sneaked through a crack. She leaned forward and pulled the drapes across the window. Then Phil announced, "There we go, babe, good as new." She turned and looked at the statue. From across the master bedroom, she couldn't see the web of cracks that covered it. It had been one of her favorites, for what she knew must be very transparent reasons. "Now we just have to..." Phil started lowering the repaired statue to the small roll-top desk near the bed. "Let it set for a year or two." He gingerly slid it onto the desk. "There," he said happily. "Good as old." But then Joanne heard the statue land against the wood. A loud sound, and the mother holding her child fell apart. Some pieces flaking off, while others, covered with the porcelain glue, melted away. "Damn," he said. He looked up at Joanne. "I was being so careful." "Never mind," she said. "Give it up, honey." Phil looked down at the pieces lying on the table. "It's worth a lot of money." "It was worth a lot of money. Now it's just a wreck." She saw that Phil looked as disappointed as she felt. She picked up her handiwork from the insect-like nose of her Singer portable. "Hey, how do you like this?" Phil stood up and walked over to her. "What is it?" he said. "It's a blouse," she laughed. "See, the arms will go here and there, and the front..." "Oh, yeah, I see it now." He rubbed his hands on his sweatpants, and dried glue flaked off his fingertips. "It's for Kyle," she said. "Do you think she'll like it?" He shrugged. "Hey, what do I know about teenage girls?" "A lot more than you did 3 weeks ago." He walked away and then fell back on the bed. "Huh, I'm not too sure about that." She put the blouse down and followed him. "Phil, I've been thinking that maybe..." She came to the side of the bed standing next to Phil. "That we could get something for Andy. Something to make him feel welcome." Phil looked up, grinning. "How about a volume?" "Very funny, but I mean it. He's such a sweet boy away from his mom. And he gets scared so easily, I..." She looked down at Phil. Her husband had started staring straight ahead, and then he opened his mouth, curling back his lips to expose his fangs. He stuck his arms out. "I'm coming to get you," he said in a low, near Transylvanian accent. "And then I'll get the boy." "Phil!" she laughed. He stood up and started lumbering toward her. She stood there, letting his zombie arms encircle her, while he prepared to nuzzle her neck. "You have such beautiful veins for sucking the blood," he said. She giggled as he kissed her neck and turned her around, ready to throw her down on the bed and, she guessed, ravish her in a classic B-movie fashion. He wriggled in the drawer. It wouldn't open. It was like some kind of Chinese trick door. "I'm in here. Now how the hell do I get out?" He rolled his body, his plump little doll's body that seemed to have more and more feeling, back and forth, rattling around. But the damn drawer didn't budge. "Okay," he thought. "Not the first time I've been in a tight spot. Just have to concentrate. Relax." He brought his hands up to the top of the drawer. He felt the wood bars running over the drawer, and then the bottom of the drawer just overhead. "There," he thought, "I've got an idea." He grabbed one of those struts and used it to inch his drawer open. For a moment, it seemed too heavy to move.
but then he felt it slide just a bit. Nothing like a little concentration to solve a problem. He grinned. Concentration can be your best friend. And he thought with pleasure about the first offering he had ever made to Dembala. The woman had turned out to be stronger than he had imagined. She actually fought back, punching at his face, his balls, before she ran down the stairwell screaming. People would come out of their apartments, he worried, and that would spoil the sacrifice. But it was too late. Rabbit people mind their own business. Good. God-fearing, tax-paying wimps mind their own small-minded business. That was one of the first things he had learned. So he took his time chasing her, letting her think she might get away. Down the stairs, then through the basement. Why would she go in the basement, he wondered. But then he figured out a reason. And all because he took his time to concentrate, to think. Yes, he thought, she was gonna run through the basement to another set of stairs, and then into another side of the building. Right up those stairs, to the elevator, to her apartment, to safety. He nearly tripped over her high heel shoes on the way down, but he didn't follow her beyond that. Instead, he stopped. He ran back up, and he was there waiting for her when she started coming up the other side of the building. It was too funny. She nearly ran into him. She almost, he smiled at this, thought he was a neighbor, someone who could help her. But one look at him and she dropped that notion. I don't look like a neighbor, he thought. Too many nights sleeping with the rats. Too many winters wearing layers and layers of other people's clothes to keep warm. Dead people's clothes, filled with their smell, sometimes even the smell of their fear. He actually liked that smell, but no, he didn't look like anybody's neighbor. She backed away, and Charles Lee Ray began saying those words taught him by the holy man. The Gree-Gree shaman who had taught him about the power. Never for humans, he had said. It would be an abomination to do the ritual sacrifice with humans. Not for what I want to do, Charles Lee Ray thought. The woman screamed. He saw that she wasn't young, but she was strong. Maybe she was a jogger, maybe a weightlifter. Now she cowered in the stairwell, cornered. He finished the first prayer. Dembala Gora Stamba Kano, mighty Dembala, grant me the power, I beg of you. And he felt the Gree-Grees, the dark magic, all through his body. Almost sexual, as his hands closed around the woman's neck, and he repeated the chant over and over, louder than the woman's sputtering. Even her kicks didn't bother him. This was just too wonderful. And it was only the beginning. His patient work was rewarded. The drawer was open. He saw a bluish light, the window, and the outline of Andy's bed. He waited a moment, just to make sure that the little bastard wasn't there, waiting for him, ready to ram an ice pick into his nice new head. Then he sat up. Chucky relaxed his face, that stupid doll face, letting the puffy smile cheeks go flat. He saw the top of the bed and Andy's sleeping body, only a few feet away. He's asleep, Chucky thought. Perfect. I have all the time in the world. He thought happily of the first thing he would do right after the change. Right after he took over Andy's body, and poor Andy's soul was forever imprisoned in the good guy. Why, he thought, I'll just have to smash the doll into a million pieces. I'm sure any shrink would understand my anger. Chucky grinned in the eerie glow. Thank you.
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been chapters 13 and 14 of Child's Play 2, the novelization of the movie. Once again, I want to say great job to Cecilia Spears and Bonanza Jellybean. Both of them are $15 patrons, and both of them are voicing characters in this book. Cecilia Spears plays Kyle, and Bonanza Jellybean plays Andy. Great job, ladies. Really great job. Love being able to edit your lines in. Sounds so great with you guys included. Thank you so much. I hope you're having fun with it, too. And as far as tonight's chapters go, guys, I love it anytime this book gives us more backstory on Chucky. And we got more in chapter 14 there. That was kind of cool to go back and see his first Damballa sacrifice. That was a really neat thing to read about. I'm really digging the relationship between Kyle and Andy in the book better than I did in the movie, even. You know how it starts off kind of rocky, but, you know, Kyle sees. He's a good kid. I like that we're getting more in-depth with the parents, as I've mentioned before. They're not just throwaway characters in the book. But the biggest thing that I'm really digging about this book, like I just said, was the backstory on Chucky. You know, I'm really enjoying that. And I hope there's more of that coming. You know, back in, chapter 11, we got the history of his childhood and stuff and him killing his mom. And now we got his first sacrifice. The more and more they let us get in Chucky's head, the more entertaining this book is. Like whenever he was sitting outside watching Kyle and Andy on the swing set. That was really cool. You know, how he's sitting there freaking out that they're going to find Tommy and his plan's going to be ruined or at least kicked into high gear sooner than he wanted it to. But we all know where we're at in the book, guys. You know, Chucky's there, Andy's lying in bed. We all know what comes next. Looking forward to that. On a little side note, today I took my kids to Sonic, and my daughter told me I had to order her kids' meal in the voice of Chucky. So it was like, yeah, I'd like to get a chicken strip kids' meal with an applesauce and a raspberry slushy. They probably thought I was nuts, but my daughter got a kick out of it. All right, guys, until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening. Be safe out there. Be sure to wash your hands and don't touch your face. And I'll see you soon.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? Darker.